What a beautiful song, right? Dave Matthews Band, Crash. I've loved it ever since high school. Was 15 years ago? Yeah, and it's still so beautiful. I don't think that one will ever lose its wonderfulness. Welcome back to The Pursuit of Living Well. Today we're on lesson number 20. I am determined to see. We've been quite casual about our practice periods thus far. There has been virtually no attempt to direct the time for undertaking them. Minimal effort has been required, and not even active cooperation and interest have been asked. This approach has been intentional and very carefully planned. We've not lost sight of the crucial importance of the reversal of your thinking. This is our first attempt to introduce structure. Do not misconstrue it as an effort to exert force or pressure. You want salvation. You want to be happy. You want peace. You do not have them now because your mind is totally undisciplined and you cannot distinguish between joy and sorrow, pleasure and pain. And you cannot distinguish between love and fear. You are now learning how to tell them apart, and great indeed will be your reward. Your decision to see is all that vision requires. The exercises for today consist in reminding yourself throughout the day that you want to see. Today's idea also tactfully implies recognition that you do not see now. Therefore, as you repeat the idea, you are stating that you are determined to change your present state for a better one, and one you really want. Repeat today's idea slowly and positively at least twice an hour today, attempting to do so every half hour. You must set your alarm for this one. It's the first exercise that's going to really establish structure in your thinking, and it's going to be by far the most powerful one that we've done yet. The extra repetitions that you apply this lesson to any situation, person, or event that upsets you. The extra repetitions should be applied to any situation, person, or event that upsets you. You can see them differently, and you will. What you desire, you will see. Such is the real law of cause and effects as it operates in the world. So, to say that we don't see now only suggests that we're having trouble being present in the moment. When we're fully present in the moment, we can look at something consciously with love, and we could see such thing as all possibilities. Though we may not know what is the greatest possibility for us. And so just by opening up in the present and being determined to see, something can click there that hasn't clicked before, because you're being fully present in that vibration of love, being determined to see. This raises your vibration to a new level of thought that can come into your mind, that can see someone differently, where a new idea could arise, where a new path you can take can arise. Something will be seen in a different way, or some thought will form in a different way. You have to practice this really every half hour and more. If this is, something that you're really apt to want to see, you have to desire it. And you apply this specifically to any situation, person, or thing that upsets you throughout the day that you are determined to see. So instead of reacting to it, You're going to trade that reaction for a lesson that says, I am determined to see. Fall back. Be determined to see. Breathe deep. Let it go. Turn away. Remember to honor yourself. If the situation just feels like dishonor to yourself, really fall back and just say, I am determined to see. Maybe it's your time to leave. Maybe it's your time to stand up for yourself. Maybe it's your time to walk out of the room. Maybe it's your time to voice your opinion. Who knows? But being determined to see is a prerequisite for a new action. And that new action is what's going to bring a miracle into your life, where something may come together, something may fall apart, but the universe is bringing you greater potential than you have been open to receiving thus far. You don't want to be in the past, you don't want to be in the future. When we are in either one, we're not seeing correctly, we're not able to decipher from the two. You have to be present. So this is a meditation for today. Every half hour of the day, if you use it that way, and even more so during the day, you're gonna become really aware of your thoughts, but breathe with them. And after you become aware of the thought, just take a couple moments and focus on your breathing. Let yourself continue to be present and see what happens in your mind. You will experience a shift today, I can guarantee you. But you gotta be present, and afterwards I want you to continue to be present for a little while longer and just focus on your breathing. When you're not thinking at all, you give your energy momentum to raise itself to that vibration of love that you're giving to yourself. You're honoring yourself by being present, you're honoring God, you're honoring the moment, you're honoring to be still and let things be as they are. And so naturally you're gonna have new thoughts or new perspectives arise from this, and this is very exciting stuff. So today, lesson 20, I am determined to see. Some excerpts from the text. This is a new chapter, chapter 4, The Illusions of the Ego. I'm gonna read to you the introduction before we get to right teaching and right learning. So, the Bible says that you should go with a brother twice as far as he asks, or go with a sister twice as far as she asks. It certainly does not suggest that you set him back on his journey. Devotion to a brother or sister cannot set you back either. It can only lead to mutual progress. The result of genuine devotion is inspiration, a word which properly understood is the opposite of fatigue. We talked about fatigue and how, I think in two lessons ago, where we're fatigued when we're not living authentically, when we are constantly keeping up with judgments, and these things are disheartening to us. They tire us, they make us weary. To be fatigued is to be dispirited. But to be inspired is to be in the spirit. It's a new way of thinking of the word inspired, in the spirit. In the spirit. We are in the mind of God. We are the mind of God. We can create because we are like God, but ultimately we are in the mind of God. And that is to be in spirit. And when our minds are thinking with thoughts of love and truth, we're inspired. We're inspired because we see something new and we want to act on it. We see the miracle right there. Though we don't may know what it is, but we know it's going to happen because it feels so good to show up authentically. It feels inspiring. To be egocentric is to be dispirited, but to be self-centered in the right sense is to be inspired or in spirit. The truly inspired are enlightened and cannot abide in darkness. So, to be egocentric is to be dispirited, but to be self-centered in the right sense is to be inspired or in spirit. So you hear often about self-love, and I talk about self-love, and what does that really mean, self-love? Sometimes we see people love themselves and they come off as narcissists and they come off as very egocentric, and They lack the will to consider anyone else at all before themselves. They lack compassion. And that's not real self-love. Real self-love is to recognize that you are part of something greater than yourself, but it's to first and foremost and primarily be concerned with your well-being and with your heart center. So to be in self-love is to really be centered within your heart, not within your mind. Within your mind, we can't tell the difference between things, but when we're in our heart, we can feel the difference between things. And when we meditate, we take that further, and that feeling in our heart, even when we can't decipher it then, because sometimes your heart can feel things of sadness, and that sadness feeling can come into your mind, and it can, you know, make you question what to do, to let go, to hold on. You don't like this feeling isn't bringing you any clarity to what you're supposed to do right now. Is this love or is this fear, and how do I respond or how do I act to this? So then we meditate on it, and we come into our power center, we come into our intuition. And when we meditate, when we get really present, we're not in the past, we're not in our future, we're not trying to analyze that feeling of sadness or sorrow or whatever it is we might be feeling in our heart that seems like it's not love. Understand that emotions are a part of this building up and falling apart thing about the universe that is trying to potentially give you an experience that you want. So feel in your intuition what feels right. And how we do that is by not imagining ourself as the center, but as ourself as part of the greater whole as one. And when you think about it in terms of that, you lose the ego in your decision, and you even lose the feelings of sadness. And you think rationally for a greater cause. You feel in your intuition, even though this may feel sad, even though I may have to let this person down, even though I might have to grieve for a little bit and move past these feelings, there is something on the other side. I can feel it in my intuition. It feels expansive. But eventually I know I'm going to swim through these feelings, and there's going to be a clearing, and there's going to be something else there for me. And so your intuition, using your intuition, really brings you a sense of trust. Trust in everything that we're doing here. Trust in God. Trust in the universe. Trust in yourself, because you are the instrument in which the universe and God is using. Think about your life this way. I know you want to think about yourself as a creator and one who can manifest a life and down to the detail of how you want to live it. But it's not gonna happen like that, because you don't know what is the highest possibility for you. You don't know what is your greatest potential. Only God knows this. Only the universe knows this. And so if you just open yourself up to receiving that guidance that comes through your intuition, it may come through as thought forms, it may come through as just feeling of expanding, a bigger breath, it may come through as a shove that you need to push through this. Your intuition communicates you in sometimes abstract ways, and just the more you pay attention to it, the more you get in tune with how your body is being used as an instrument by God and by this universe to bring you to greater potential and to greater happiness. You cannot see your greatest source of happiness, but it can. And so be a conduit here. That's why when we choose love, we're letting ourselves be a conduit in this world. We're doing God a favor. Us as in the mind of God. When we light that up, we light up our own reality. When we light up God, exponentially we light up our own reality. But not just our own, the whole population as one. Become a part of that. So trust your intuition and accept that surrender before your own wants and desires will get you a whole lot further than trying to manifest and create those desires, which are all egotistical Okay, so self-centered in the right sense is what I'm just describing here. You can speak from the spirit or from the ego as you choose. If you speak from spirit, you have chosen to be still and know that I am God. These words are inspired because they reflect knowledge. If you speak from the ego, you are disclaiming knowledge instead of affirming it, and are thus dispiriting yourself. Do not embark on useless journeys, because they are indeed in vain. The ego may desire them, but spirit cannot embark on them because it is forever unwilling to depart from its foundation. Love can never depart from God, but the ego can walk along and pretend that it has, and it can come up with all of these desires like we just mentioned, but eventually one desire is going to lead to another desire, is going to lead to another desire. And so the objective here is to not just desire. You're going to desire. You know, you're going to dream. You're going to have ambitions. And know that those are all instilled in you, that the universe wants you to have those as well. But don't act on the desire as like a chasing game. You wouldn't chase a guy, right? You wouldn't chase down something that is going to make you feel obnoxious, right? Well, to chase down a desire is sort of an obnoxious thing to do. Surrender to the feeling of inspired truth and belief in your mind, and these desires are going to manifest on their own. Surrender is such an important, and it's a wonderful practice. If you want to read a book on this called The Surrender Experience by Michael A. Singer, his first book is called The Untethered Soul, and it was one of the first books that I read about meditation, and I read right through it because he speaks about meditation in a very personal way that is so understandable, and his examples are just, he takes everything and he makes an example of it just to further show how meditation works as a practice in elevating our potential and becoming present. As we're present, we can surrender and we can let things be. When we're in our mind, we're in our past, and we're in our future. Get as present as you can be. The surrender experience, the surrender happens in the present moment. It's where you can make a really powerful choice to not dwell back and forth, but to surrender and to open yourself up to the greatest possibility to happen for you. Admitting that you don't know is surrender. In the book, A Surrender Experience, this man retracts kind of from society and he surrendered. He surrenders many things. He surrenders his life every day to see what comes to him. And what came to him, all that came to him, the community that he built because of this surrender experience, the way that the government came to him with a huge task and creating something and a very profitable income for himself all came through surrender. And it's a real story. So I did this myself. I did the surrender experience. And when I did that, I went off my technology for a couple of months. I shut down my website. I shut down my blog. I got off of social media. And I was just one with nature, and it was kind of a magical time because I really got present to the point where things would happen to me, like I'd have these connections with my animals. I had two cats that I had adopted at the time. One of them, I'm sitting in meditation and I'm so into my meditation, I'm probably 45 minutes in. I would meditate for long periods of time during this surrender experiment. And out of nowhere, I just open my eyes, and right as I do, my cat is putting a lizard in his mouth. And of course, I freak out like, Charlie! And he just looks at me with this proud face like, I caught a lizard. But it was just the timing that I happened to open my eyes right out of a meditation. I wasn't ready to come out of it. The eyes just opened and the cat put a lizard in its mouth, and I witnessed that. To me, that was something unique. It also happened another time where I was sleeping and I was having a dream, And the person that I was living with at the time was walking down the hall in the middle of the night, and just as he was walking down the hall, I was actually having this dream about him, and I woke up like abruptly in my sleep, like because it turned into one of those like nightmare dreams. I was PTSD, and so many of my nightmares, many of my dreams were just nightmares. It was awful, and I'd always be waking up in the middle of the night, afraid to go back to sleep because I didn't want to continue to dream these things. But I woke up in my sleep abruptly, just as he was walking down the hall, and I just looked at him in such confusion, like, I was just dreaming that you just did that, and there you are. And this is so weird, but I'd have many weird moments like that. And so then, along with the career, my health coaching that I had to surrender at the time because I wasn't feeling well myself, didn't really give me the, I felt like, the knowledge at the time to really offer and be there for someone else because I really needed to apply it to my own self. I was going through much deeper levels of healing than I'd been known to before, and I had to give myself my full presence. I couldn't show up for somebody else when I'm suffering inside and I'm struggling with my own health at the time. Especially with something like PTSD, you have all sorts of bizarre symptoms. Don't know when they're gonna come about. You're not really reliable at the time because you're not functional to stability, really. But as I surrendered, I began attracting people in situations that needed me in different forms. I started consulting creatively. People would ask of me to help them with their websites, to help them with their blog, or to create content for it because they know that I had done this for myself and I'd done it successfully. So I would meet these opportunities, and that built me as a creative person. So then I started meeting artists, and artists who would want my help with representing themselves and taking their work and introducing it, creating proposals for different people or different places, and trying to get their art out into the world, give them exposure, help them to buy, help them to sell. I met an amazing art dealer who I am lucky enough to be working for, and I learned a whole lot about the art world. And it was a perfect timing for me because I wasn't really able to express myself in any way at the time. I was having a very difficult time in understanding myself. As a writer, I was blocked completely. Anything that I would write was all about my PTSD, and I just wanted to throw it away. But when I began to look at art, I sort of began to see myself and to see just the abstract of the universe in ways that touched me, that made me feel alive again, and that gave me a perspective again, which I was lacking because I was so crippled by my fear, which was my past, or an anxiety about my future that I was never gonna get well. And art made me present, and it helped me to see things about myself and just see things. And then I met other artists. And then I met people who would ask me to help them with the creative direction of certain things. And people came to me for my mind. And I don't know what it was about my mind. I never really thought of myself as a creative in that sense. But as soon as they asked me to do it, I was like, absolutely yes. And I stepped right into the role as if I'd known the role the whole time. And it became a fun point during my PTSD that I was having all these new experiences in regards to my career that I was enjoying, that I was good at, that I was getting attention for, that I was getting referrals for. And I, since that time, I believe I worked on maybe nearly 26 projects creatively that just came to me one after another. And to me, that's a huge miracle because I was off the radar for a while. I was off the map and I wasn't going out for these things, which was myself before. I was going out after everything as a health coach. You know, I was very analytical. I was going about things in what was all the right way as a health coach and in running your own business. And this was completely the opposite. I was just letting things come to me and I was, yes, yes, yes. And I had some great experiences along the way. And even when I was off the map, because these experiences were coming to me, I was still building my network and a new network in that way. When I thought that before, that the only network that I knew was from, you know, the life that I had created when I first moved to New York was all that I had. And that wasn't true. Because some of that network was good for some of my work and some of it certainly served no use anymore. And I was building up now this new network that was aligned with new things that were coming to me. And they still are in my life and they still come to me with referrals or I have this or I have that. And it all came from just surrender. I can't do anything at this time. I have to succumb to this PTSD, but I'm still here. I'm still meditating. I'm still being present, still practicing my truth. I had to get away from all of the noise of social media technology, my phone, and really be present because those things are so distracting from yourself and knowing yourself and knowing what you really are, what you really come from, this nature, the mind of God, your spirituality, your intuition. To really observe these things, it takes a huge degree of surrender. Most people aren't willing to go there because they're already so caught up. So I encourage you to read this book by Michael Singer or to take my story to heart and maybe try a surrender experience of your own. It doesn't have to be something drastic. You don't have to shut yourself off completely from the world, but maybe take a technology detox. Maybe take a break from your phone or set limits and give yourself just open space and open time where you're surrendering to whatever can come of the moment. If you are searching for something in that surrender, stop and use it as a time to just get really quiet. The quieter that you get, the more that you surrender, the more that things come through that you wouldn't have imagined or regarded before, because it may have not been along your path. So you may not have recognized it. You may not have thought you had time for it. But when it comes through during this precious space, it gives you a moment to reconsider your path in a bigger way. Maybe change direction or maybe evolve your direction. Maybe collaborate your direction. Who knows? Surrender is so beautiful. And it's also part of acceptance. And that is a big attribute of healing. It's hard for us to accept, but when we surrender, the universe has a greater plan in mind, that there is a cycle in life, that this is not the end of it, that we are invested in somewhere in a God's mind that we can't see or we can't fathom, but we can sense and we can know when we get really present, when we get really quiet. Our mind goes there. So we know that there's something else out there. We just can't see it yet. You know, like dimensions or other lives out there. We just can't see them yet, but we gotta know they exist. We're not the only things in this universe. The kind of intelligence and creativity that we have. Taking an astronomy and astrobiology course right now through Harvard that is teaching us about how to explore life in other forms in the solar system, what to look for, and the origins of life and how life was created. And then following that, I'm taking a philosophy, knowledge, consciousness, and God class from MIT. And I'm really excited to see the difference in theories here. I'm assuming one will be very scientific in origin, and I'm assuming one will be very theoretical. And I myself have so many theories that I'm excited to see them get tested and responded to. So these classes are free that you can take on edx.com, or you can go to some of these universities around the world. Some of these top schools offer free courses. And in a way, it's a way to get your toes wet, maybe see how you feel about the subject if you're interested in really studying it, maybe to add knowledge to a degree that you already have, or just some specialty knowledge on a path that you're already on that you can say, I teach meditation, and I talk about spirituality, and I'm taking these courses that are going to add to my conversation here, especially philosophy and especially astronomy. When we talk about the universe, metaphysics, the study of what's beyond the physical, is spirituality. And this has a great scientific relation to quantum physics, which is a real thing. Spirituality is a real study. And that's going to be part of my astronomy and astrobiology course. So I'm excited to share those things as I'm learning them. And if you're interested in these courses, look up on edx.com. Top universities in the world offer classes that are free. You can pay for a certification, and when you do, you pay for the class to be graded. Sometimes the class is just graded to be, and it's free, like my philosophy class, and I'm so excited. I get to test my philosophies with real philosophers from a number three school in the country, and I'm not afraid that I'm not smart enough for this school because this is a subject that never leaves my mind. So, whether I sink or whether I swim here, I'm gonna enjoy it because I'm gonna get so much out of what's really in me. And the same with the astronomy. I just can't turn away from that subject, but interior design is my passion, and that's what I will return to school in the fall to finish. But it's fun to take these other classes and test my knowledge and just broaden what I already know and what I don't yet know. I can't believe I've been speaking for a half hour. So that's it for the introduction of the illusions of the ego and the lesson that we just did, being determined to see. Might want to rewatch the beginning of this because with all the talking I've done, you probably already forgot the lesson. Set your alarm, a reminder, every half hour, or just leave it up on your phone because you look at your phone every half hour and see that I'm determined to see. I'm determined to see this person. That's all you gotta say. I'm determined to see this work. I'm determined to see myself. And don't force a thought of coming through of what you want to see. Just by being determined to see, you're surrendering to a perspective. And when you surrender, it's the most powerful thing you can do because something will come through you. But you do not create yourself. Builds a trust and a knowledge of how to reach greater potential and brilliance within yourself. Thank you for watching today, this very long, probably the longest video. Got really into it, but I hope you got a lot out of it. And in sharing my experience, I hope that you will gain something out of your own. Be determined to see, know the difference between self-centeredness and egocentrism. Read the book, A Surrender Experience. And before you read that, they're very quick books to read. An Untethered Soul, if you want to get really into your meditation practice and understand what it is that you're doing. Michael A. Singer is a genius. You can probably YouTube him and, hear what he has to say on some things. I might go do that right now. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you tomorrow.